All right, so here is our taste of a little bit more of a complex JSON file. What we're going to do then is now we're going to create another one with a different structure. And then what we're going to do is then actually retrieve information from it. We're going to create the database and then retrieve information to display it in an HTML file. So let's create another brand new empty document. Let's go to File, New again, and this time let's save it. We'll keep saving it in the same folder. I'm saving it still in the same Start folder. This time we're gonna save it because we're also in this folder because we also want to add these pictures to the database. I want these pictures to be part of the database so that I can retrieve the pictures. We're gonna save this as, we'll call it social.json. This is going to be a database full of information of social networks. Social.json. Our structure, of course, again, is curly braces, which creates the object, the JavaScript object. And then inside of the curly braces, we create each particular table, so to speak, a key and a value. The first big key that we'll create here is called social colon. And this, we already know, is going to be full of a bunch of social networks. Here's our structure so far. Social in quotes, double quotes, you should be using double quotes. Colon and then square brackets because we're going to list several social networks. I'm going to create each key first and then we'll go back to fill in the value because I want to explain what's going to be in each key. It won't be a complete file yet. This is what I mean. Inside of line 3 now, we're going to create the first object, so curly braces, and inside of the curly brace, our first key, our first field, will be called graphic, space colon, space comma. This is not properly filled in yet. This is not correct yet. But I'm going to create each of the keys here, something, 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 and then we'll go back and fill in a particular item because I want to explain what the structure will be. So, we're going to have graphic. We're going to have a description, which we'll just call desk description. We're also going to have the name. We're going to have URL. And that's the last one. Graphic, description, name, and URL. I want to display a graphic of the social network. I want to have a description of the social network. I want to have the name of the social network, a short name of the social network, and I want to have a link to the social network. Those are my four fields. For every particular social network that I'm going to save in this database to retrieve. So if you notice, I'm going to let you finish typing that. If you notice in the folder, we've got nine little thumbnails of social networks. They'll have a very common name. Pick 01, 02, 03, 04, etc. dot png. They're named in that way so that we can retrieve them algorithmically easier. Instead of naming the YouTube picture youtube.ping and the Vine picture vine.ping and so forth and so forth, we're naming them in a common way because the computer, the logic behind the computer is going to more easily be able to retrieve a picture that is named in a common way instead of a very unique way, like youtube.ping, vine.ping, instead of picture 1 ping, picture 2 ping, picture 3 ping. So the graphic name in quotes, we'll start off with pic01.ping. That's the name in the folder. Let me just confirm. Yes, in the folder, pic01, 2, 3, all the way up to 9. So the graphic is pic01.ping.
So you say that this way it's going to be easier to retrieve, right?
Yes, because when we write an algorithm, when we write a way to retrieve them, it'll be easier to retrieve them via just changing it from 01 to 02 instead of YouTube, instead of Facebook. It's just going to be easier to retrieve it by number. The description of this first social network, in quotes, we will say that this is long-form videos. The name of the network is YouTube. And a particular URL, a particular address, http://youtube.com/vmcampos.jr. Just as an example of some social networks, I've got these. And be careful here, this is JR, not IR. Junior, JR. This is underlined like a link, so it cuts off the J, the descender of the J, but that's a J. vmcampos.jr. This is one particular social network. This is the format of my data. A graphic, a description, a name, a URL. So we're going to do this a few more times for the other networks. Maybe not all 9 of them, but I want to do at least 3 or 4. Then the algorithm will take care of it. But I then now want to add 2 or 3 more networks. So I can just copy and paste this. I'm going to copy the object, which is the curly braces, numbers 3 to 8. I'm going to copy that. Add a comma at the end of line 8 because we've got a new object. Paste. So we've still got a graphic, description, name, and URL, and it's now going to be pic2. The name, I guess we should flip them around, but the name, this, what's the next network? Vine. That one is short form videos. And this address to access this Vine account is vine.co, not .com, .co/vmcampos. We'll add one more. Comma after line 14, of course. Graphic is now 03. The third network is Twitter. So we'll say description. 140 character quotes. And it's Twitter. And the address is twitter.com/vmcampos. These 3 will work so far. We'll add the next ones in a little bit. Let's add 3 items here. No comma at the end of the third object. It's the last one in the series, so no more commas. So we've got this data in a database. We want to retrieve it. We want to have a front end that will pull from this database and show it on screen. That'll be an HTML file. It'll be HTML, PHP, whatever. It'll be, you know, some sort of front end technology. So make sure that this is written correctly. We've got social and then colon. Don't forget you've got that closing square bracket, line 21, closing curly bracket for the whole thing, and then curly brackets for each object, comma, two commas, and then no comma. Same thing when we deal with each object. Graphic, comma, description, comma, name, comma, URL, no comma at the end of that. It's the last item in that series of that object. So we've seen this before, objects in objects. What we will do now, make sure you save your file. Let's go to File, Menu, New. Let's create a brand new file. So I've still got my social JSON file right there. And now I've got a new file, which we will save as, still within this start folder. We'll just call it index, save as type HTML. Index is usually the default name of a web project, so we'll keep that standard there. So index.html, save as type hypertext markup language. We will create a very, very basic HTML5 document. So this will take us back to 2 months ago. Doc type HTML. You should remember this. We're about to create this HTML document, head and body. Meta car set, so this is all stuff we've seen before. So just a quick 10-line HTML5 file so that we can access the data in the JSON file and display it on screen. That hail might have actually caused damage. Okay, so this is a basic file here. What we want to do is to be able to retrieve the data from the database. We're going to use jQuery, which, remember, jQuery helps us to write JavaScript code faster and more efficient. The jQuery motto is write more, do less. No, wait. Write less, do more. The other way. write less, do more. So that's what we're about to do. We're going to write less and be able to do more with it. We need to access the JavaScript library. We'll just access it from the web. We don't need to download it and all of that. So let's go back up to line 6, and we will add here a script tag so that we can connect to the jQuery library online. Line 6 will create the script tag, and we will access the online version. So inside of the script tag, src equals, and this link should take us to a version of jQuery, which is http://code.jquery.com/jQuery-2.1.4.min.js. We've added that line, and that will give us the ability to use jQuery commands, which are more concise, rather than the older JavaScript commands, which would take us more writing to more coding to accomplish the same tasks. It's one of the big reasons to use something like jQuery. Write less, do more. code.jquery.com/jQuery-2.1.4.min.js. Script source. Don't forget to close your script. /script. On screen in the body, we will make a simple button. When we click the button, we're going to pull one of those social networks out of the JSON file. So line 10, we have a way to create a very simple button. We're not dealing with jQuery mobile. So remember, with jQuery mobile, we had data role equals button, data icon equals user. We don't have that because we don't have jQuery mobile. But we will just use the basic button tag to create a very simple button. Nothing fancy. And in the button tags, we will write social media. Go ahead and save it and run it. What we should see is the heading 1 text retrieving JSON data and a simple button which does nothing. If you see anything weird, check your code, call me over. But you should see basically, let's run this in Firefox. Launch Firefox. Should look something like that. Clicking that, nothing happens yet. But this is the code so far. In order for this button to do anything, we should give it a unique ID so that then the JavaScript knows that we're talking about that button. So on the button tag, let's add the ID attribute, and we'll call this BTN social. This is my button to retrieve social media. This can be anything we want, of course, but I'm putting BTN because when I see a list of it, when I see that code elsewhere, I can hopefully quickly tell that this is attached to a button about social media. And after I pull something out of the database, I want to show it on screen. So next, I want to have a placeholder to then display those contents of the data. So next line, line 11, we'll create a div, a division, a placeholder to display what we take out of the database. And that needs a unique ID also so that the code knows to take that data and put it in a specific place on screen. So that needs an ID. We'll just call it result. Take the data out of the database and show it in this result div. So if we If we save it and run it, it still looks just about the same, but there's a placeholder down there. Nothing happens yet. And the way we will retrieve the information is through JavaScript / jQuery. So on line 12, we'll start the script tag again, but this time we'll break script into two lines because we're going to write a lot of JavaScript here. Not a lot, but we're going to write several lines of JavaScript here. We had script up here because we're just referring to a JavaScript library, but here we're going to write the JavaScript. We could write our JavaScript in a separate JavaScript file as we've done in previous times, which is usually recommended, but here, just to learn this, to get the concept, we're going to have the JavaScript and the CSS and the HTML in one file. Really, the recommendation is each one of those languages in its own file, but I just want to keep it all together so that we can easily understand it as one file. So we've got script / script, and the script is JavaScript. So what we need to do inside the JavaScript, line 13, is create a variable. There's a special kind of variable. This can be called anything, but I'll explain why in a moment. We'll call this XHR equals new space XML, capital letters, HTTP, capital request, open, close, curly brace. So this is very specific here. Capital XML, capital H, but then lowercase TTP, and then request R, open, close, parentheses, curly brace. This is basically the way that we will be able to access the contents of that JSON file. This HTML file wants to be able to look inside of the JSON file. And so using something called the XML HTTP request method, we will be able to pull that data. We will be able to look at the data and pull it out. So XHR. So that can be called anything, but we're just calling it the initials of the particular function here that it allows us to request the data from the JSON file. It's named in this way because oftentimes we're going to be retrieving data that is on an actual server. So there's the HTTP part of it. We're making a request. And XML, not exactly sure why XML, because we're dealing with JSON data, but sometimes code is just the way it is, and you just have to learn the way it is. So basically, this is to be able to retrieve the data from the JSON file. And we can make comments here because it's an HTML file. So, to retrieve the JSON data. It's JavaScript, so I can add the single line comment at the end right there. Next line, we're going to define a function called getSocial. So I'll have open, close, parentheses, open, close, curly brace. This will be that when we click the button, social, we will get the social network. So let's add a comment right here, actually. Function to get the social network when button is clicked or pressed. When we create this XHR variable, it then gets a lot of abilities because we're creating a new instance of the XML HTTP request. This has a bunch of built-in commands. We've basically then given this variable the powers of this function in order to be able to write things a little bit more efficiently. So we're going to fill in the git social in a moment. Let's come back to that. It's going to be a longer one. Line 20 or so, so after the function, we will then say xhr.open, open close parentheses. The xhr object has a lot of abilities. This is one of the abilities, one of the methods of the object. We're actually then going to open the file. So that's what that open means. We're going to open. In quotes, inside of the parentheses, we're going to write get. This is a command that a web server would understand. So even though we're not really on a server, this will still work. We have this particular command that we can, in all caps, yes.
Okay.
This one matters here, in all caps, get. Get something from the server. Still in the parentheses, comma, space. Well, what file are we trying to get from? So in quotes, the name of our file, social.json.
Can it all be like lowercase,
lowercase, get? No, on the get, it should be uppercase.
All uppercase, but I mean all lowercase,
but then. No, get does need to be all uppercase.
Because that's just the name of the method, right? You're going to get the file.
We are.
Yeah, we're going to save it all up to the instance, right? It's HR.
But this is the standard of when we deal with HTTP requests. It's built into the HTTP standard. It has to be capitals. Then one more thing here. What particular file? Social.json, comma, space, true. That one, I forgot to look up exactly what that one's about, but just have to put it in here, true. So we're getting a file. Which file? This one. True. I don't know what true means, but that's what we need to do. The point of this file, basically, of this line, is actually open the JSON file. Next line, we have xhr.send. Now I'm just going to say null. Send the request. This is just a sort of a standard operating procedure where we are creating an object to request data, and then here we're trying to actually open to get the data and then sending null. Again, this is sort of just the way it has to be. And actually, looking at my notes, we wrote this, but actually we needed to write this inside of the function here. I got ahead of myself. So we're going to move these lines, the dot open and the dot send, we're going to move them so that they're in the function, get social.
That means that these things will happen when we click the button.
If they're outside of the get social function, they would want to happen right away. They're not attached to any event. These two suddenly want to open the file when we don't need it yet. We're actually supposed to put it inside of Get Social,
which is that they will only happen once we click the button. So actually move those inside of Get Social. We only need to get that, we only need to get the data once we click the button. What should be outside of the function is the event handler for clicking the button. We want to, using jQuery, reference that particular button. So we've got $, open close parentheses. This is jQuery. So here we're basically going to be talking about a particular object on the screen. The object is button social. So in quotes, # btn social. # because it's an ID. So basically we're saying there's some object on screen with this ID, button social. Right there, button social, line 10. We want to attach .on when something happens to that button, run the get social function. So this should be familiar from things that we've done. In the on method, in quotes, we've got click. Once we've clicked the button, do something. The something is after the click, comma, function, open close parentheses, open close curly brace. Once we click on the button, that button, do something, anonymous function, do something. The something in the curly braces is that function, get social, open close parentheses. Before we go further, I want to make sure this is working, because line 22 assumes we've got jQuery working. If jQuery is not working, none of this will work. But what I mean by that is that we wrote properly line 6. So in order to make sure that we've got this working, on line 17, where my get social begins, I just want to do a very simple alert. It says works. It doesn't matter, but I want to see, if I click the button, will I get a pop-up? A pop-up can say anything. And the rest right here don't matter, doesn't matter just yet, but I want to make sure that I'm clicking on a button and that I get a pop-up that says works. If I get the pop-up that says works, that means that this is working, get social is working, jQuery is working. So go ahead and save and run that. Click your button and we should get a pop-up. An alert box that said works. Works. Let's take a moment to make sure it all works. The main reason that it might not work is that you didn't type line 6 right. Does anyone need a little help that it did not work for them? Raise your hand if it worked. You got works. Great.
Is that space necessary after script or SRC?
Yes, or else it would think it's some weird command called script source. No, script and then source. So space, yes. So obviously we want to check our code once in a while like this to make sure we're on track before we get complicated. This is nowhere complicated yet. So anyone need any help? So obviously one wrong quote, one wrong dot.
Yeah. didn't see it. I mean, it's very
remember, you can also check your console.
Yeah.
Right. HTTP instead of HTTP.
HTTP. Oh,
HTTP.
Oh,
HTTP. Expected an expression that's saying
oh, I don't need that second one. Yes. Well,
okay. The console was nice, so.
Before we go further, I give that some straight code here. Can you see what
I'm oh, sure.
ID result. You're just missing a angle bracket. Didn't render it as HTML.
Okay, yeah.
And angle bracket, that's a parenthesis.
Oh, okay. Like that one?
And it's a square bracket.
Square, okay, I'll do that. This one? This one?
The less than
symbol. Oh, yeah.
And you can remove that parenthesis.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's save it on that and let's see what we've got.
Yeah,
and I would run the Firefox as well.
Yeah. Okay.
Don't close that down.
Okay. I'll just
no, go back to Notepad right here.
Okay.
And then run the menu on Firefox.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Firefox. Okay, so in a couple weeks,
click the button.
Okay, let's see if we can.
See again that what we'll do is we'll open the console, which is F12. Console character encoding. Okay. So this one thing and then syntax error missing semicolon that's telling us over here on the right line 56. So first of all character encoding. And of course, I don't think here's a big thing. You open the quote and close the quote.
Yeah.
Which goes back to the on.
Right.
This should actually be
right. Okay.
See that it goes back to on. And then it closes here.
Yep. Got it.
And it closes function. And then it closes gets function. Just to confirm.
Thank you.
Anyway.
Yeah, they have a, yes, they, yeah,
that is split there. I'm not sure if it's split there. Is it the opposite?
Yeah.
Might be the opposite. Google is Picasso. Picasso.
All right, so just to check at this point, this was to make sure our jQuery was working, because line 22 using the dollar symbol only works when you've got jQuery working. And then being able to click and run get social gives us that alert. We no longer need that alert. We could comment it out, but I know it works, so I'll just delete it. Delete your alert or comment it out. I'm going to delete the alert. I know that it's retrieving get social function. Next, inside the function of get social, this is where it's all going to happen. This is where it's going to pull the data. Right here, we've got basically a connection, line 18. We've got a connection to the file. Now I want to pull stuff out of the file and then display stuff on screen. That's what the bulk of things is going to happen inside of get social. So line 17, what we're going to do here is then type xhr.onload. This one's going to work a little bit differently than open and send. The syntax of this one will be equals function open close curly brace or open close parentheses open curly brace close curly brace. So different sort of syntax. Why? This is just the way it has to be, basically, because this syntax here is defined open and send, but this one on load is a little bit different, and we need to then do multiple things here. This is just basically, here's the file, get it. Here we need to do a bunch of operations when we load the data of the file. So, line 18, I'm going to create a variable in here, var, we'll call it response obj, object, equals. We're trying to get data from the database that will give us objects, right? Everything in the JSON database is an object. There's an object of YouTube, an object of Vine, etc. So this will store that information. The object that we get in response from trying to get the data equals JSON, J-S-O-N, in all capital letters, dot parse, open close parentheses. Parse is a method of JSON. JSON has a variety of jQuery commands that we can do with the data. We're going to parse the data. We've just suddenly got a stream of data. We're going to parse the data. We're going to deal with the data. In the quote, in the parentheses here,
xhr.responseText with capital T.
We're getting this data. It's right here. This is the data. This is the text from the response. We're getting it out of the file. We're going to parse it. We're going to deal with it as JSON data. And we're putting all of that stuff into that object, into that variable.
It's just plain text. Next line. My concept here is that I want to randomly choose a social network. I have, at the moment, 3 to choose from, but I could have 9 or 900. I want to choose a random network, so I want to create a variable that thinks of a random number, at the moment between 1, 2, or 3. Later it could be between 1, 2, 3, and 20, or between 1 and 90. So I want to create a random number here. VAR, we'll call it random SOC, it's a random social network, equals. JavaScript has built in methods to create random numbers. It's got a built-in object called math, and we will then do dot random.
This creates a random number. Math dot random, this object of that method, this is built into JavaScript. Random number. Yes?
Could you have like multi-popular, multi-clicked-on, or there other game?
Yeah. That would require a little bit more effort in that we keep track of which numbers or which clicks have happened more. And we save that information also to the JSON file, or maybe here inside JavaScript. And then that way we can make a determination about what's the most popular network and such. So here we're going to choose a random social network based on a random number. The weird thing about random numbers is that they're weird, that they are created between 0 and 1. So 0, 1, 0, 258, 0.29, 0.1572789, random numbers between 0 and 1, which are infinite. So we need to narrow our randomness a little bit, because I've only got 3 social networks. I don't want to get social network number 99. I've only got 3. So actually, be careful here. This always happens when I do this. I did close that statement, but go back into the statement before the semicolon. Don't type this after the semicolon, and before the semicolon. We need to narrow our range of randomness. It'll be random, but between the range of how many social networks do I have to choose from? So we'll do this. response object dot social dot length. That length is a property we often use with arrays or JSON data. Length is just the technical term, the JavaScript term for how many. How many are there in this database, in this array? How many social networks do I have? And the term social comes from our JSON file, social. In here, we have a group of objects under social. If we had another group called users, right? Users, colon, blah, 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 blah. We could reference everything in the users section the same way I'm writing here. Response object dot users. I'm saying let's get the data in the social section, and all the data currently is stored in the response object. Because up here, line 18,
we've said, let's get the data. Let's get all the data and put it in that variable. And now let's specifically, from the social section, give me the length. How many social networks do I have? In this case, I've got 3. YouTube, Vine, and Twitter. So the dot length of social is 3. And oh, I missed something here. math.random*, and then the rest. Sorry about that. We need an asterisk here. And then responseObject.social.length. What's happening here is just some basic JavaScript where random is going to give us a random number between 0 and 1. But actually, I want a random number between 1, 2, or 3. So one way to do this is take the random number, multiply it, that's multiplication, multiply it by the total number of social media networks we have, 3. So let's say we get 0.1 times 3. That'll be a more whole number instead of 0.1. There's no network 0.1, but there is a network that is 1, or 2, or 3. This is going to think of a random number, multiply it by the total number of objects here, so it's not going to go up to 10, or 20, or 40. It can only go up to the length, which is 3. But it would still give us a fractional number, maybe 2.1 or 2.99999. I want to round that. So what we'll do is we'll wrap parentheses around the whole expression here, except the angle, except the semicolon. Wrap a pair of parentheses around all of this, because we want to then round whatever result this becomes. We want to round it. We want to round it to a real whole number. So we're going to back up. And we'll write here math again. Dot floor. So the floor is down. What's up?
Ceiling.
Ceiling. Rounding down is floor. Rounding up is ceiling. So we're rounding down. Whatever number this becomes, we round it down. 0.7777 times 3 gives us some fraction number. Rounding it down, which gives us a 1. You might have a 2.999. Round it down, it's a 2. So we're going to get a whole number by rounding it down. So all of that to create a random number. A random number that makes sense in our case, because we've got 3 networks to choose from. The cool thing about this algorithm here is now we can add 7 more social networks and we don't have to change this, because dot length will always automatically check how many we have in the object. So we can have 10 more networks, 10,000 more networks, and it will always choose a random number between the maximum number, between 0 and the maximum number of networks we have in the JSON file. Yes?
To back up a quick second, how does the variable response object recognize that you're calling the specific social.json file? Could there be more than one JSON file, and how does that link directly to that specific JSON file?
Okay, so going backwards, that comes back here, variable response object. JSON.parseX HR response text. That then comes back from right here. XHR open get that JSON file. So there's only one JSON file in this directory. There could be another JSON file in a different directory, but we would need a different path right there. This one is calling the JSON file within this folder. Okay. We're getting it, and then we're parsing it, and then we're using it.
But then there's a name right there, right? The social is what we're looking for. We're looking for the JSON file named social.
Yes, right here, line 21. We're looking for the JSON file named JSON, social.json. That's what we've got right there in the folder, social.json. We should write some notes here then. line 18. Stores all the data from the JSON file. Line 18 is storing all the data from the JSON file.
We opened it here. We're trying to retrieve that information. And then right here, we're actually storing it for us to use in response object. That's a shorthand for all of the data in the database. The next line over here is creating a random number,
create a random number based on the number of social or the amount of social networks. Create a random number based on the amount of social networks. That's what dot length is. Next line. Alert. Random soak. Random social.
This is just to see that in action. Save it and run it. Every time you click the button, you'll get a different random number within the amount of social networks we have. Notice random soak, random soak is not in quotes. Don't put it in quotes. We want to see the value of that variable. We don't want to see the word random social. Let's see if mine worked. So run it. Click one. Click two. Click zero. Click two. Random numbers. If yours didn't work, I'll check yours in a moment. But we're going to get random numbers 0, 1, or 2. Because in computer counting, we start counting from 0, not from 1. So when I get a 0, that means the zeroth object in social, YouTube. When I get a 1, that means the second object, Vine. When I get a 2, that means the third object. It's always counting from a 0. 0, 1, or 2. But it's 3. 1, 2, 3. 0, 1, and 2. It's 3 objects. That's the whole point of doing this random number and then floor, rounding it down. Because I also want to possibly count the zeroth object, which is YouTube. So, did that work for you? Do you get random numbers, 0, 1, or 2? Anyone need any help?
Give you 4 and 6.
Give you 4 and 6? Did you add more? Did you add more networks to your social? Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, I
social, if it's depending on social, the reason the mass is employed is not all the this is not the one that's why it exists.
It's I think it's in this file where
Oh, it's changed.
Yeah, no, I got it.
because on the other side of the word manner, so it's not going to be value. It's all okay. Mm-hmm. So J's the data. J's the assumption. So J's comes to this.
Just for proof of concept, we want to go and pull something out of the database randomly,
yeah,
but you don't have to have a random label. You don't have to use a random number to choose. We'll see how we use a random number.
So
you're saving all the
All right, so if this worked, we are displaying random numbers within the scope of how many objects we have in the JSON file. The next thing that we'll say here is, okay, we've got a random number, which means potentially a random object from the database. Let's display various values of that object on screen. So I'm going to comment out the alert right there. Next line. We are going to display this on screen, so we'll do var str. We're going to create a string. We're going to create an object that will hold what we will display on screen. We'll just call it string equals quote end quote. Nothing in the middle. We're creating the string object, but we're not putting anything into it. We're just prepping it. What that is going to do is display everything on screen. Next line, we will write str equals. Now we will put stuff into that string. And what we will put is one of the pictures. So in quotes, so quotes and then semicolon, we'll write the image tag. The image tag, remember, does not have a pair, but it does have the attribute of source. So in the image tag, we have the src attribute equals single quote, single quote, single quotes. Single quotes here because we've got the double quotes out here. If we put double quotes here, it'll break the quote. So single quotes right there. And then normally, we would then here have the particular graphic, which would be ping, which would be pic01.ping. Don't write this yet. It would be pic01.ping. But this would mean it would always display pic01. I want it to display 01, 02, 09, 99, 209. So I want that to be the random number that we are that we created a moment ago. So we'll have to do this. Let's have our item written like that, and then we're going to In the middle of these quotes, this is where we're going to be referring to the random number. But because the random number
is a variable, not a string, we have to put it outside of the quotes.
So just follow me on this. Inside the single quotes, we will put a double quote, and then a space. And then in between that space, a plus.
So we've got open quote, end quote now, which is fine. And then open quote, end quote right here, which is fine. We have these two linking together, no more. Now these two link together, and these two link together. So we need to end that double quote here and then start it again here. But in the middle is where we're going to talk about that random number.
And we're going to reference one of the random pictures. So, response, object, response obj, dot social, square brackets.
Right here in the square brackets, we can say, is it the first social network? Is it the second? Is it the 40th? Is it the 90th?
Well, it's going to be the random social network.
I've developed a random number right here based on the number of possible social networks. So that random number, use it to mention the particular social network in the database.
And specifically then, after that, dot graphic. Space plus.
This is pretty cool here. We're going to display an image, a random graphic from the social database.
Next line. Dollar symbol in quotes, I mean parentheses, that's the jQuery again, and then in quotes, the name of that placeholder div, pound result, dot inner HTML equals str. Getting late, so I'm forgetting it. Instead, let's write it like this.
Instead of dollar blah blah blah, document dot get element by ID result dot inner HTML, etc.
I'm forgetting the jQuery syntax for it at the moment. That's the plain JavaScript syntax.
No pound symbol here because we've said get element by ID.
I was trying to do the jQuery syntax, which I'm forgetting at the moment, but there's the long form of it.
Are
they interchangeable? They are. If I could remember what the jQuery one was, we would do that, but this is interchangeable.
Mm-hmm.
What's that? Yes. Instead of the dollar syntax, we will use the plain JavaScript syntax. Let's save it and run it. Click that button as many times as you want, and hopefully then we get different social network icons to pop up.
I almost got it.
Almost got it?
Yeah.
Let me check mine.
It's like the frame of the picture, but there's no picture.
All right, let's take a moment to see if it works for everyone. The main reason that it might not work is this line right here about displaying the picture. That's maybe the tricky part. Hold your hand if it worked.
Anyone else?
So this, what's happening here are, we're using random numbers to choose a random social network from our database. Every item in the database is assigned a number from 0 to infinity. And so we've reined in the possible random numbers by having the length, the total number of social networks. We use that to create the random number. And then we actually then display a picture, and notice the way we're doing it here dynamically. Outside of the quotes, so that it's the random number here, display the graphic field of the social, the first social, let's say, the second social in the database. So that's what's happening on line 22. We can make a comment. Display the graphic field from the random social network. Because on our JSON file, we have a field called graphic, a field called URL, a field called description, etc. So so far we've only displayed the picture. We've got other data that we can display. So we'll display some more data now. Let's display, for example, the name of the network. Let's add a new line before document get element by ID inner HTML. Before we display that on screen, I want to build my string a little bit more. I want to show the text of the network below the network icon. So we'll add string again, but this time plus equals. Recall that equals will take whatever is on the right and put it into what's on the left, dumping out what was originally there. Originally, string was empty. We dumped that out and we put in this. But now we want to add to it at the end. We've got this, and next, at the end, we want to add the following, so plus equals. To the string, we're going to add some more. So quotes, semicolon. We're going to add some more HTML. In the quotes, we're going to add a p tag, slash p. We're going to put the, the name of the social network in a little paragraph below the picture. The name of each network is automatically stored in here. YouTube, Vine, Twitter, from a field called name. So we need to say name.social.responseObject. That's how we retrieve anything in here. If I want to show the address, it would be url.social.responseObject. Technically, url.social2.responseObject. If we wanted to display the description of YouTube, it would be desk.social0, because it's the 0th item in the sequence, dot response object. We want to show the name below the picture. So the code here, very similar to this whole chunk right here, in that we also then have to end the quote here, space plus, space quote. We want to start the p tag, end the p tag, and in the middle add response obj.social, the square brackets for the particular position in the database, which is based on the same random soc button, dot name,
space plus.
Start the p tag, display the name of the current random numbered social network, and then the end of the p tag. Save and run that. And now what should happen is it's still going to display the picture, but then the particular name of that particular picture, because they're both using the same random number, which we invented right here, and we use it here and here. When we click again, it'll think of a new random number, and then display a new picture, and then a new text based on that random number.
Let's see if that worked. Twitter, YouTube, Twitter, YouTube, Vine, etc. So this is how we can retrieve any item in the database. Right here we're doing it randomly, but if we wanted to retrieve a particular one, instead of doing random, we put in the position in the database, 0, 1, or 2, or 7, or 99, or 2000. Because it's in a sequence, it's serialized data from 0 to infinity. It would be nice if we can click on the name of the network and it would go to the website. We happen to have saved in the database the address as well. So let's retrieve the URL value of social 2 to display the Twitter link. We want to make the name clickable. We want to make it an active link. This whole thing here represents the name that appears on screen. Twitter, for example. This whole thing here. This thing, then, we want to make it an active link. So we will do this. Let's be careful here. I'm going to go back to the quotes where the p tag starts, and I'm going to start the a tag, because there's going to be an active link in this paragraph. If a tag starts here, then I'm going to end a tag right there, because I want the a tag to be this whole name that is clickable, an active link. So go back to p, and right there, slash a.
Right, which you highlight. Start the A tag, end the A tag, in the quotes. Slash A, slash P, start P, start A.
Inside of the first A tag, href equals single quotes, space, target equals single quotes. Single quotes because we have to put single quotes because we've got double quotes here. It's only water. Target will say underscore blank. That'll just simply open an empty, a brand new tab in the web browser. I want it to open the particular social network in an empty tab of the web browser. So it's underscore blank. And inside of href, this is where I will pull the URL out of the database.
Very similar again to what I did up here and here.
So we will quote space plus space quote. Just getting ahead of myself. Same thing here. Quote, end quote, plus response object plus, right? Just like we've done elsewhere. I know what I'm about to do, so I'll do it already. This quote ends that whole quote there.
plus what I'm about to do response object plus quote to end the rest. There. Okay, now I want to pull out the address from the database. Response obj.social, the random social network. Random social network, square bracket, dot URL, the particular field of that particular social network from the JSON file. And that is being used in the href so that the text is an active link. All three of these now are using the same random number. It's not going to make a random number every time we see random numbers. It's using the same random number that we started with up there. It makes a new random number when you click, because random number generator is inside of get social, which only happens when you click the button. So all three of these are using the same random number for three purposes. One to display the picture, one to display the text, and one to make the text an active link. Let's see. Social media, click. Oops. Of course, response obj is not defined. There we go. Object. That has worked. There we go. There's the Twitter picture, the Twitter text, and the Twitter link. If and notice it opened in its own tab. So if I click it again, now I get Vine. So if I click on that one, it goes to the Vine address in its own tab. This was the scene outside my window earlier. Random again, YouTube. Click on that one, my YouTube channel. So I'm pulling out that data from this database with three items. And I'm using the information on screen. Vine is vine.co, not .com. So we have one more bit of data that we could use, description. We could use description. You've probably seen all over the web where you put your mouse on top of a picture, and maybe you get a little pop-up text. I don't see it here, but I'm sure we can see it all over the place. You know what I mean, probably. There's going to be a picture, you put your mouse on the picture, there you go. So you put your mouse on top of a picture, you get a little pop-up. That pop-up right there, we can use that in our project here as well. We can hover our mouse over that YouTube icon, and the description of YouTube will appear on screen. We've got that data in this database, in Desk. The way that works, it's a title attribute. So we'll add title. It's not a tag, it's an attribute, just like source. We'll add the title attribute to the image tag. So we'll build a little bit more into line 22 to display the description of that particular social network. So we've got image, source, that particular image. Then we've got, this is on line 22, we've got double quote, single quote, double quote. Those double quotes obviously close each other there. this single quote closes it right there. And so after the single quote, but before the angle bracket, because that angle bracket closes the image tag, add a space right there, and we will add title equals single quotes. So this is the title attribute attaching to the image tag to display some text when you hover your mouse over it. Same thing, we'll pull out the desk value from the social key. So in here, we'll do the same thing, closing the quotes and the pluses and all of that. So at the first time we did this, it might have looked very weird, but now as we've done it four times, maybe it makes a little bit of sense. So same thing here. Close that quote, plus, plus, quote. Same thing as we've done here. Close that quote to close this. Plus and plus, because that's where the response object is going to go, and then close those quotes. Response object dot social brackets random soc dot desk DESC. And that's it. Save it and run it. Pick a random network, put your mouse on it, and you should get a pop-up that says the description that we wrote. YouTube, the long-form video channel. Or Twitter, the 140-character quote. So in short, this is how we use dynamic content. Previously, we've dealt with a lot of static content in HTML. What we write is what we get, always. But here, we are doing it dynamically in that we've got a database full of data, and then we're pulling it out of the database with a little help from random numbers to choose a random social network. If we don't want a random network, if we want it alphabetical and such, we have other ways to do that, but basically we're pulling the data out of the database to display it. Let's see. Hover your mouse over the picture, short form videos. Click again, hover your mouse here, long form videos. Click on that one, 140 character quotes.
Can you put the link under the picture?
The link on the picture?
Yeah,
yeah, we would do something very... Also, yes, we would do something very similar. We would move this whole href part, we would move it before the image. We could leave the slash a where it is, but then we would move this whole ahref part before the image, and then the picture and the text would be clickable.
So the mouse would put a couple by the a and the b tag.
Yes, the a tag will cover them both.
Mine's working, but I'm getting not well formed in the console.
That's fine. You're going to see that not well formed. And that's just because it really is expecting your JSON file from a server. We're not on a server, so it's a little confused, but we can ignore that.
Yes.
Could we see what?
The data file.
Yes, the JSON file.
Okay.
Yeah, I couldn't get... I try to be VM Campos everywhere, but someone beat me to it on YouTube, so I had to put JR. So speaking of the social file, let's go back to the social file and add one more network. We've got YouTube, Vine, Twitter, Google+, pick four. Let's go back to the social. We've got the algorithm, basically. We've got the technique to display the pictures. The
items from the database. Now we can add as many items to the database and it will still work. The algorithm works. So we need to add a new object, a new social network.
We've got 0, 1, 2. Next is 3. So same syntax here. I'm just going to copy and paste. I'm going to copy everything from 15 to 20. That's a complete item, although a few of you noticed that if you type it wrong and copy and paste it more than once, it'll copy and paste wrong. So now that we've got it right, I'm going to copy that object and paste it into line 21. Don't forget the comma. We've got a brand new object in the series, so a new comma after pick 3. Next is pick 4.
The name of this is Google Plus. The description is Google's social network. And then the address is google.com/plus, the plus symbol, Victor Campos. So there it is. A new object in the database. Save this file. Run your index, click it, and then eventually, randomly, Google Plus shows up. You'll see its name, you'll see its description if you hover over, and if you click, it should take you to My Google Plus. Here, of course, we're manually putting in items to the database. We could, of course, create some JavaScript and HTML for it to ask us, what's your social network? What's your description? What's your URL? What's your picture? And then submit, and this would add it to the file, but that's for next time. At this point, I want to save it, and let's see if it works. Again, be mindful of the syntax, comma on line 20, and then no comma on 26. And then, of course, commas between each of these. They shouldn't change. Comma, 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 no comma, because it's the last item in this object. Social 3, 0, 1, 2, 3. Run it. There's YouTube, Google Plus, Twitter, Vine, Google Plus. The text, click, and then you get Google Plus. We didn't need to change the HTML. The HTML is running. The JavaScript is running. We just added more data to the database, a JSON file. Does anyone know what this one is? Number 5.
Pinterest.
Number 6.
Instagram.
Number 7. Tumblr. Number 8. Facebook. Number 9. SoundCloud. Yeah. So back on the JSON practice end file, there's what we did right now. It's all complete in that index file, and that social JSON file is also complete, written slightly differently,
all on one line. That's also valid. So on one line, it kind of looks nice this way too, that here's this one whole record, and it can all be one line, same syntax. Curly braces, the first key value, graphic, pick 9, comma, desk, comma, name, comma, URL, no comma. So that's in the end file, in case you want to look at it. We did it ourselves, slightly differently, but here it lists the other networks with example descriptions and addresses.
And the index file in there also is a little bit different. We're about to run out of time, but in the index file, if you want to peek at that one, this was also a little bit different in that it has a little bit of CSS, which we didn't quite get to, but this is a little CSS so that the text is aligned below the font, the graphic. See, on ours, it's to the left, and this is to the left, and there should be a little bit of space there. Well, if you look at what I did in the end version, I created a little CSS to define the width of that, and a little text alignment and margin, so that it's not bumping up against the button. So here's our version, and we also wrote this. I didn't do that on the other one. But this text, this graphic is right next to the button. Instead, I add a little bit of margin, and I put the text centered, whereas on ours, it's to the left. See that, how it's to the left. So you can, we won't do it, but you can look at it, because sometimes you want to learn how to do something. No one's here to tell you exactly how to do it. You want to look at other people's code. Our code should be about 99% the same. The difference is, you'll see there's some style, and then also, when we've got the response objects and so forth, we've got a div before it, div center, and that's how it knows to do this CSS. I've also got something here that I didn't mention at all, but here's a loop to display everything in the database in one long line. Instead of randomly choosing an item of the database, this loop right here will just display every picture in order. We can change the order and such, but here's just displaying everything from the database. So notice the example, the end example looks a little different. You click it, and oops, because it's commented. I'm going to uncomment it. And the result there will be, you'll get the random one at the top, yes, but then at the bottom you'll get a list of all of them. And all the data, the picture, the description, the name, the address. And the address is also clickable. And this is not random, so you can click on that and that's random, but this displays everything there. So that's something you can play with on the end version that we didn't quite get to, but it's good to reverse engineer other people's code and kind of see how it works. And so we spent today talking about JSON, because that's going to lead us then more advanced next time to talk more complexly about databases, because what are those four operations that we can do with a database that I mentioned earlier? Save data to a database, retrieve data from a database, edit data in the database, and delete data from the database. Those are the four basic operations. We added data to the database, although manually. I want to do it by asking. We retrieved data from the database. We didn't talk about yet altering it or deleting it. That's next time. But that's our intro to JSON and NoSQL databases.
No, just that social network there in your description. That possibly there will cut off the rest of it for some reason.
Oh, does it?
It closes the quotes. So, See, it cuts it off right there.
Oh, good eye. Then actually, we want the apostrophe because it's possessive, but I believe we can put a backslash there. Let me just confirm that. I believe you can put the backslash, or maybe not. Now that confused it. Okay. There has to be a way to display that, which I have to look up. No. Okay, I gotta look that up. There is going to be some way to display the apostrophe, because I want the apostrophe, but it thinks we're closing it. Good point.
There's more than one kind of apostrophe.
Oh, also, yeah, that's a footmark, technically.
Well, two apostrophes.
Two apostrophes. I don't think so, but let's see. No. Yeah, we'll look it up. But there's our intro to JSON. I'm going to put my work in the network folder in case you want to copy, and I'll upload the videos, of course, and I'll turn the printer back on. Any general questions?
Can I turn the CSS?
CSS that you wrote for that review extension?
Yes, but you have a copy of it too. If you look, if you got the JSON practice end file. So that's it for the moment. Make sure you enrolled. All right, you got the sticker and you enrolled. And if you would like, you can sign out, or I'll sign you out. We'll put my work in the network folder in just a moment, and we'll do it again Thursday.